Hello guys, and welcome back to another MCreator building tutorial. So today what we're going to actually do is finish that building part for the project that we've been working on the dungeon. So we'll be doing that today, and there's a few different things that we need to actually set up. Now, one of the sites that we're going to be using today to actually generate the command that we need is called mcstacker. We'll be using the give command to give ourselves a chest for basically placing it down in our structure. So we'll need this for our chest. Now, to get that all prepped, what we need to do is we need to search up chest. And then what we'll basically do is under this particular loot table variable is what we'll basically put in our loot table that we want. Now, if you want your mod itself, then you would do mod colon and then the loot table, so loot table. And if you're just using vanilla Minecraft namespace, then it would just be loot table, like that. All right, so just to keep that in mind, what we're going to do now is just quickly go into MCreator and I'll show you the loot table that I do have set up. So for the loot table that I actually have set up, I have it under our registry name is basically the part that we're going to actually paste into the MC Stacker site. So what we need to do is it's a dungeon loot. So dungeon loot underscore loot. So that's basically the loot name that we're going to use. This is the command that we're going to basically use to get our custom chest with the loot table. So we're just going to copy that, Control A, and then you can also hit Control C, or you can hit copy and then it'll copy that particular thing. So once you have that set up, now loot tables are pretty straightforward. You need it under the loot table type, so the chest is what we have it for. That I have it under the Minecraft namespace just because it's a little bit easier to work with, and then the registry name is basically what we just typed in. The other thing that we have is set up our minimum rolls and maximum rolls, so it can roll anywhere between 3 to 5 times. And the items can vary between a golden, a couple loot items and a couple junk items as well. So that's basically a simple loot table, how it's set up. You can add more entries if you want, like that. You can actually add more pools and set this to 0 and then say anywhere from 1 to a higher number. And basically that will have a random chance of basically disabling or not. As a like a bonus thing if you set it to 0 and 1. So just a couple notes when you're actually creating new loot tables. So once you have that, save it, and then what we need to do is actually go in game to basically place down our chest. All right, so now with our command that we basically got, we can paste that in and we should be able to get a chest with a custom MBT. We can test if that has MBT by showing advanced toolchips. That is F3 plus H, and it should say that there is MBT tags attached to it. So if we place it down and open it, as you can see, this is our loot table that we basically generated. We can actually place a few of these just to see what the loot is actually generating, and it is, so that's perfect. Let's go into our structure, and what you do want to do is you want to basically place, if you've placed any chests that you want loot with, you want to break them, and you want to replace them with your custom MBT one. Now, don't open the chest, because if you, as soon as you open the chest, the loot table will basically be disabled. So once you place it, don't open it, don't even look inside it, just leave it alone, and go over to the other one over here, and we'll just break that one just for good measure. So basically, now we have our chests updated. There was one thing that I basically did, and I removed that lantern right up here. Reason for that was because I don't think it was bright, or it was too bright for the spawner. And I did test it over the weekend, and things weren't spawning. So I'm just going to put this chest in here for now. All right, so Another thing that I should probably note is if you want to set up multiple rotations, you have to do this through the structure itself. So in our case, we have the structure like this, and we have all the structure voids, which are these little red dots underneath, and we've used the fill command to fill it in. Now, more dynamic structures like this are going to be a lot harder to actually fill in, so I suggest maybe filling it in with stone or some type of material between certain parts, but the only downside with that is if you do that, then what it's going to do is it's going to actually spawn in that whole entire section to be stone. So instead, it would be probably better to go ahead and fill in all the other four rotations with the structure voids like we did with this particular one. Now, basically all you need to do to basically rotate it, you don't actually have to build it a second time. Once you get everything, all the blocks set up, just basically save it as a dummy one. So we'll just call it test, and then we'll save it. And then what we can do is we can place down another structure block here. Then we can go to the load tab, we can load test or whatever one that we basically saved it to, and then we can offset the coordinates. So basically I've offset it 19 directions that way and then one direction that way, and then I could basically paste in our structure again. So just to kind of prove that I did this, we will just quickly load that in, and it's the exact same spot. Now the only problem with that is structure voids don't actually load in with the structure. I don't think it's possible to actually include the structure voids. So that's the only downside with that particular system. So all the structure voids will have to be placed back with the fill command in the parts that are empty spaces right now. So we'll only be doing the north direction today, so what we need to do now is actually test for the rotation gateway of the entrance where we want basically people to come into. So I want basically this part right here, where I'm standing, to be basically a face of a cliff side or something like that, and I want the block right on the outside of it, of the structure, in front of this little 3x3 area to be air. So we actually need to test our location for that particular doorway. So what we need to do is go into our structure, find the access point. So in our case, the access point of the structure is right where the structure block is. So right where this green, red, and blue lines meet. You can also see on the F3 screen where the axes meet. This will always be the case for the structure when it's actually generating in. So in our case, this is the corner that we want to branch off from and test the amount of number from the access point. So because it's spawning at the access point, we want to make sure that the blocks at this part right here, which we have to calculate the distance and then the distance up, are basically set up the proper. So I already know the coordinates, but just for good measure, I'll basically show you how to calculate it. So all we need to do is place 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and then we will have our 15th block right here, which is right underneath our doorway. So what we'll be doing is checking our coordinates. So this is east and that is west, so that is our x coordinate. So we need to go positive x 15 to for our starting location on our x. Now the other thing that we need to do is actually calculate how many blocks up. Now because our structure is actually elevated, what we need to do is actually calculate where we need to place the starting point. So we know it's x 15 positive, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 6 is going to be our starting location for where we're actually going to be testing for the blocks. So 16 and then 15 for X, and Y is 6. So when we go into the additional conditions, we'll need to make sure that we have those numbers written down. So after we've done that, all we need to do is basically save it as our structure. So we can save it as north. I have already saved it as north before, so basically that's what we will basically be spawning in. So we have our chest set up, we have our spawner set up, we have the actual decoration done. So this is all ready to go. All we need to do is basically do the stuff on the MCreator side, and then we'll be able to test it in the actual program. So let's go back into MCreator. All right, so first things first, we actually need to go to our structures, resources and structures, and then we need to import our basic model. So I already have imported the north one. As you can see here, it's already imported. So this is our structure that we'll be basically using. The other thing that we need to do is create a element called structure spawn, and then we're going to basically configure that. So I already have one in place. We're going to select our spawn structure to spawn to our structure direction. Now there needs to be one direction for every part of where the conditions are going to be met. So if we have additional conditions, it won't be compatible with the random structure rotations because it's hard. I don't think it's possible actually to test for the rotation it places it at least not currently. But we can control the rotation if we rotate it manually, which is why we're doing it this way. Now, the spawn probability, because there's so many different conditions that we're basically testing in this particular procedure, I'll show that in just a second. We need this at the maximum number. So this is actually not going to be near enough to what we can actually spawn. So we're actually going to need to spawn more than just this one structure to make sure that it actually does generate, or it'll be like super rare. So max this number out and then move on to the structure group size. These both need to be set to 1. You don't want it generating in clusters, so just basically set that to 1. Random rotation, again, it'll be enabled by default, so disable it, as you don't really want it to rotate for this particular additional condition. The ignore block to ignore when placing, set that to just the default one, and the type of reference ground direction. Now it's underground, so we just want it to basically first motion blocking block, and then our structure or spawn location, we want it to be underground. This will be set to ground by default, so make sure to set that to underground. And then our spawn X, height, and Z offsets, set these all to 0. This will be important for actually testing the structure. Last thing that we need to cover is the structure world type. So to enable the structure to spawn, you actually have to set a particular dimension for it to spawn in. So make sure to set it into one of these. You can also set it to a specific block type, not recommended, but you can also set the biome at least, and then it will only spawn in specific biomes if you want it to do that. Now for additional generation condition, this is basically our script that we have to test for the entrance. Now I will cover how to create this from scratch. So the first thing that we need is a general if statement. We're just going to go to flow control, grab an if statement, and then what we need to do is basically test for 3 different levels. There's 3 levels going on here. So this is our first one, our second one, and our third one is down here. Now these are basically the levels for the Y axis, and then these 3 parts right here inside that is basically the X axis offset. So we will be testing for all 9 different types of blocks. I'm sure you could probably get away with a repeater, but for most people this will be too hard to actually set up, and I have covered repeaters and stuff before, but I even struggle with them with additional conditions. So this is why I did it this way, because it's a lot easier to do the manual labor and type out the coordinates by hand than have to set up a whole bunch of variables and then have it potentially not work. So let's quickly just add a operation. We'll go with a AND gate because we need to make sure that all the conditions are true, and then we're going to basically place down it like that. So the other thing that we need to do is add our two blocks like so. So after that, what we need to do is we need to go to our block procedure and we're going to grab a tag. Now we do have a tag already set up. I forgot to cover that. We do have a tag though. It is under spawnable blocks, and then I've basically specified stone, granite, diorite, andesite, dirt, gravel, all the different types of ore, and all the different types of terracotta as well. So that's basically under that particular tag, and that's the tag that we're basically going to be setting in this part right here. So that's going to test for our basic location for where the solid blocks are going to be. So I'm just going to grab this particular block. You can find that under the block procedures. It's right down at the bottom here. The math operators you can find at the math, and the X, Y, and Z already comes with it. Numbers are also under math. So we're just going to place that in here. Now our starting location needs to be set to X positive 15, because that's where our first part is going to be. Now the actual access point of the block is going to be X, Y, and Z. Now if you want to offset the test location, you have to basically use the X plus and then the value that you want to test for the location at. So in our case, because the error is going to be on the negative side of the block, what we need to do is test for basically Z minus 1, and then we'll basically testing for the on the other side of the access point. So in our case, this is where we're starting. For our error, this is a material type. You can find that under blocks itself, and then scroll down and there's a material type right here. I've set this to error. So basically error, and then I've basically offsetted the coordinates, so it should be 15, 6, and 1 for this particular level. Now what we need to do is basically duplicate this. I'm going to remove those two blocks actually, and then we're going to update the coordinates from 15 to 16 on this group, and then 17 on this bottom group. So that's one row on the level 6 done. So we actually need to create another and statement. And then what we're going to do is we're going to put this in external, and then we're going to basically place that down right here, duplicate that one that we just created, and then what we're going to do is update the Y coordinates to 7 all the way down for that entire group. And then we want to duplicate that one more time, and we want to set this one to 8 on the Y axis. So we're going to increase that number by 1 at each time. So that's basically the procedure set up right here. The only other thing that we need to do is, because it's condition, it has a return value. So what we need to do is actually go to flow control, grab a light blue or cyan, I guess, return value, and then we need to go to logic and grab a true value. Now this one inside the if statement should be returning true. The one on the outside should be returning false. So if it does not have this condition met, then it's just going to return false and not spawn the structure. If it's true, it will spawn the structure. So after we've done that, we just need to add it to our green box right here, and it's all set up. Alright, so now that we have that all in place, there is one last thing that I didn't mention, is we needed more structures. So the easiest way, once you have your additional condition set up, your structure set up, you can save it, and then you can hit this button right here for duplicating, and then we're just going to go test structure 2, and then we're going to duplicate this a fair amount of times. Now, did start seeing results around 9 times after duplicating it. So we're going to actually duplicate this about 8 times. So 5. So that should be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 6. And then we'll duplicate it another one, 7, 8. And we need one more, so 9. And then we will start up MCreator and we'll test this out. All right, so I am in the test environment. I'm just going to actually just name this something. And then we're going to go into world generation options and I'm going to set this to desert. I'm actually familiar with this particular save, desert. And I know that this particular seed actually is on land. The last time I recorded this, because I recorded this as my second time recording it, because the quality, I forgot to set the resolution back to 4K. It was an ocean biome and it was really hard to find anything. So I'm just going to do it on desert because I know it's a mainland and then we can actually test it there. So we'll start the generation up and it should only take a couple moments to load in the actual save itself. And perfect. All right, so there's a desert biome here. It's actually a pretty neat little save. It's just a little patch of plains biome in the middle of an entire desert. I don't know if this is deliberate on Mojang's end, but it's a pretty cool thing to actually start in. So the seed again is desert. It's been like that for a few versions of Minecraft now. So all right, so what we're going to do is we're going to actually go into game mode and spectator, and then we're just going to go underneath the soil and we're going to see if we can't find a structure somewhere nearby that we basically generated. Now it is lit up, so it should be a little bit easier to find. It looks like there might be one down there. There's also blue vines, so this is potentially one. All right, so there is one here. As you can see, it spawned in pretty much the ravine. This one actually has both of the wings. Now, with larger structures over 16 blocks, there is a chance that the structure will actually spawn in parts. So there may be a wing or whatever not spawning in. That's just down to how Minecraft has their generation set up. So let's actually go up here. Now, the difficulty is on normal. So we'll kind of just act like we're going into the structure and we'll set our game mode. I'll go in creative just to basically test it out. And okay, so entities are spawning. That's a good thing when you're actually designing a dungeon. It needs to be dark enough so the spawner can actually spawn the skeletons. Let's see here. Where did the other one go? I thought there was two of them. Oh, yep, there is two of them. The other one didn't go anywhere. All right, so we can just hop over here. We'll test our loot tables. Yes, that one works. He's going to probably trigger the... Can you trigger it? He can trigger it, I think. Maybe? Yep, he can actually trigger that. That's pretty cool. All right. And just test our other one. Perfect. So we got a diamond on that one. So that's pretty cool. Alright, so let's go not into the lava. We'll set our game mode back to spectator and we'll see if we can't find another one. Now, they should be pretty rare because we don't have a whole bunch of them generating. There's only 9 of them. But they do spawn regularly. I think this one might be a different one. Yes, it is. Okay. So this one actually is in a very nice location. It's pretty much at the edge of a cave or a bottom of a cave. It's in the cavity, I guess. Oh, no, there's a top part up here. So you could technically find it. And it has both particular wings like that. So you can see that it basically spawned in the little cavity there perfectly and it generated that way. So let's see if we can't find another one. Just keep going this direction and we'll see if we can't find. Kind of have to have your eyes peeled when you're searching for these things. Sometimes they're out in the distance like that one right over there. So take a look at this one. So this one has both wings as well. That's perfect. And it goes down. So let's take a look at the entrance. So it spawns in the ravine. this might have been the one that we already went to. I'm not sure. Maybe it's a different one. We'll just keep going this direction until we find another one. Okay, so these chunks are loading in. You can kind of tell when the water starts dripping and stuff, the lava's falling there. So we're loading new chunks. There's another one right up ahead, so we'll check that one out. We're under the ocean now too, by the way. So cave entrance, very nice location. And we got both wings on the side there, kind of the dungeon part. So you can kind of see how rare the actual structures are. There isn't many other ones around by the looks of it. So it's only so many blocks. So yeah, you guys kind of get the idea how it's all set up. So hopefully you guys enjoyed the build. Next build, what we're going to be working on, I have this one already planned, and it's basically a desert temple. So I wanted to kind of reconstruct that, see if we can't make something a little bit more sophisticated and maybe more detail and stuff like that. So we'll try building something like that next. That'll be next week on Tuesday, so definitely tune in for that. I will provide the workspace and for all the different models and extra bonus parts for the structures in a repository on GitHub, and then you guys can basically download and use that in your own mods for the resources and textures and stuff like that as well. So outside of that, if you're new to my channel, don't forget to subscribe, comment down below, rate the video, and I will see you guys next time. Thanks for watching. Peace out.